Good morning again. It's great to be here. Nothing sets your nerves on fire like Gabriel and Tom Ricks introducing you. So, I don't know about all of you, but I have a problem. And I know those of you who know me well say, dude, you have a lot more than one problem. But I do have a problem, and here's one of my problems. And it's getting better as I get older. My problem is this: I forget things. Sometimes I forget little things. Sometimes I forget bigger things. Sometimes I forget important things. And sometimes I forget why I'm even doing the thing that I'm doing. Or even how I got there. You're one of those you walk up the steps and wonder what you do when you got up there and what you're looking for. And if we're not careful, not only can we do that personally, we can do it organizationally. In fact, we can do it so well that we forget the main thing that we've been called to do. And that's what we've been talking about this week through all of our priorities. And that main thing is the priority of evangelism. Evangelism and how we reach out to those in the world, evangelism and how we do church planting, evangelism and how we do biblical leadership, evangelism and how we do it in our churches and across the world. And so I want to give you a gentle reminder today, and it's so unlike me to give gentle reminders, but I'm going to do my best talking about why we need to continue to reinforce the main thing of evangelism. The first is, obviously, it's biblical. And I don't think as biblical scholars around this room and all the things that you've been gifted and told and helped to do, I don't think you need to be reminded of the biblical mandate for evangelism. And we've talked about the Great Commission being at the heart of all that we do. There's also a biblical passage in Luke 19:10, the story of Zacchaeus. You know the story well. A man whose life was transformed by Jesus. And at the end of that, there's a little phrase in Luke 19:10. It says, "For the Son of Man came to what? Seek and save that which was lost." And if that's the mandate of Jesus, then it needs to be our heart as well. It needs to be the purpose that we live into. And of course, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, which gives us our mandate to go, not only across the world, not only in the country, but here's the tough one sometimes, across the street, or across the chair, or across the table. It gets a little more intimidating personally when we try to think about it in that context. And so if we're going to live out God's purpose for our lives in evangelism, we need to know that we have a biblical mandate to do that. This may come as a shock to you, but the EPC didn't make this up, right? It came from something far deeper and more significant. Secondly, my general reminder comes from our founding fathers and mothers. I was blessed to be at the first General Assembly, ordained in the first class in the EPC, and so I was two at the time, but there were people who were amazing in their thinking, founding out the denomination. And do you know what their primary question was in that first General Assembly? What is it that we're doing that is so distinct from everyone else? In other words, why do we need another split pea? Why do we need to have another Presbyterian denomination? And their continual answer and pushback on this was, it's really quite simple. We are going to prioritize evangelism. That is why we will exist and why we will flourish and why God will bless it. In line with that, to make sure that we understood that thing, they did a crazy thing. They put it in our name. Like, there's going to be this dude, Bob Stauffer, generations from now, and he's probably going to forget why we're doing what we're doing. Well, how do we keep the main thing the main thing? So let's put it in the name so he has to read it every time he walks into his office, right? They wanted to embed it so deeply in our culture that they put it in our name. But not only did they put it in our name, my third general reminder comes from a document called EPC Perspectives on Evangelism. And you see some of that up on your screen. It's a document that's available. I encourage you to get it. It really kind of highlights why we do what we do. And let me read just a couple of pieces of that document. In terms of the mission of the church, the EPC Constitution declares the first duty of the church is to evangelize by extending the gospel both at home and abroad. Under our EPC values, we express the priority on evangelism by starting it in our governing documents as the first duty of the church and the first priority of our work. In the Book of Government 4:3, By the way, I have a book of order. I just don't know where it is. But in the book of government, 4:3, the local church, it is the primary mission of the local church to evangelize, making disciples by extending the gospel both at home and abroad, leading others to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, providing for the nurture of that faith, the evangelistic faith, that all might worship the true God and grow in grace and in sanctification. What is the responsibility of the session of your church? Fortunately, it's answered. Book of Order 18:3c. What's the main thing that your session ought to be thinking about on a continual basis? Here it is. To initiate the ministry of evangelism as the first business of the church, and to seek to lead persons to an acceptance of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. What is, Book of Order chapter 19, verse 4f, what is the presbytery supposed to be doing? This might come as a shock to you. To encourage evangelism, church planting, and renewal within its bounds as a first priority. In fact, that's suggesting that what we ought to be talking about more than any other single thing in our presbyteries is how are we doing evangelistically? How are we doing as a culture of presbyteries resourcing our churches to live out their first priority, which is evangelism? And then the big shocker of all, chapter 20, verses 4b1, authority and responsibilities of the General Assembly. To support the presbyteries and churches in making evangelism and discipleship their first priorities and the first duty of the church. And so what we ought to be talking about more than anything else as a General Assembly is what you've been hearing, evangelism. It is our driving thing. And so the responsibility of our General Assembly is to resource our presbyteries to be evangelistic. The first primary activity of the presbytery is to resource our churches to be evangelistic. And we are to be a resourcing arm in making that happen. And I'll tell you, brothers and sisters, that's why the church health team exists. That's why our church planting team exists. That's why our world outreach team exists. And that's why our effective biblical leadership team exists. So sometimes you might go to a presbytery and get confused, like, is this really our first priority? Or a General Assembly, is this really our first priority? Or many churches I walk into who have not seen somebody come to Jesus in decades or can't even remember the last time anyone had come to know the love of Christ. We've lost our way. And so this is my gentle, ever so gentle reminder that this is our first priority. It's what we've been called to do. And finally, to try and capture that idea, we have developed, you'll hear more about the three circles and the process from those who will follow me, but we have developed a summary sheet. It's called Putting the E Back in the EPC. That's Dean's language, which we love. But it outlines for your church what's important. And it's not just about doing evangelism. Three circles is important, right? It's important that we know how. The number one reason people say they don't share their faith is not fear. Do you know what the number one reason is? No one ever told me how. And we can't fix fear. We can't fix what goes on in people's hearts and spirits. But we can fix the problem that nobody ever told me how. And that's why we live as the church health team in the EPC. But it's not enough just to tell somebody how to share the gospel. Our heart is that we want to do more than that. We want to build an evangelistic culture in our church that takes full advantage of every opportunity that we have in the life of our churches to share the good news of Jesus. And so that's why we exist, that's what we wanna do, and we wanna take the next few moments to celebrate evangelism. I'm hearing amazing stories from all over the country about what God is doing. God is so good, and I think when he believes we're serious about evangelism, we're gonna see a movement of God that can't be contained, and I can't wait for that day. Somewhere in heaven, Bart Hess and George Scotchmer and Ed Davis and all these other great founding fathers will smile upon us like they're finally getting back to the future. With that, I'd like to introduce Jeff Moore. Jeff is one of our church health leaders and church health coordinator leaders, pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Aurora, Illinois, and a great thinker and a great advocate for what we're doing around the country in evangelism.
Thanks, brother. Good morning, saints. Well, if you know Bob Stauffer, you know that he has used his gentleness quotient for about the next month, I think. So well done, brother, being gentle with us. I love hanging out with Bob Stauffer because Bob is like the Holy Spirit to me in convicting me of our primary mission of evangelism. It's the one song that Bob sings, and we need to continually hear it, amen? We need to continually be reminded that we are people who are sent by God, that the world may know, that the nations may know, and that our neighbors right across the street may know. Now, my assignment this morning is to share with you a testimony, which I can't wait for you to see. But before that, just for context, I want to give you a timeline. So January 2022, I was blessed to represent Rivers and Lakes Presbytery at a gathering of potential church health coordinators at a meeting in Orlando, where we began training, we began understanding what is the scaffolding that we're building so that we can embed the primary mission of evangelism throughout all of our churches and presbyteries. So that was January 2022. And then in April 2022, we were able to do a 60-minute training right in the middle of our presbytery meeting on the three circles tool of evangelism. And so our presbytery began to be exposed to that primary tool that we've now recommended as a denomination. In June of last year, we all got fired up, didn't we, on the Great Commission, hearing from Bob Stauffer and Ed Stetzer, hearing from Jimmy Scroggins, saying, yes, 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 that's what we're for. That's what we're made for by Christ. In September of 2022, Bob and others came to Rivers and Lakes Presbytery and presented on the purpose and design of healthy churches. And so again, Rivers and Lakes was exposed to the Three Circles tool and just, again, that one song of the primacy of evangelism. And then in December 2022, we did a presbytery Zoom called The Three Circles Around the Christmas Tree, kind of prepping our people for how to be using the Three Circles tool at family and friend gatherings at Christmas. And then January presbytery meeting, 2023. I didn't have a big presentation, didn't have a big training, simply a reminder of what we're about. We watched a Three Circles video, a very brief one, and then I asked the presbytery, I said, would anyone want to come up here and share the Three Circles with us? And in the back of the sanctuary, Erin Ployce, her hand just went straight up. I will. And she came forward. But before she shared the Three Circles, all I was looking for was somebody, come on, like, you have embedded what we've been teaching, and now you're ready to use it, and just as a demonstration of that. But she had so much more. The Lord had done so much more. She said, before I share the Three Circles, can I share a testimony? Of course. Erin couldn't be with us in person, but I want you to hear her in her own words. So listen to this testimony.
About a year ago, I started to feel really convicted about evangelism. I just felt like I wasn't really doing it. I was leaving it to the experts. So just that. But then two, I wasn't doing it because I felt like other people were better at it than I was. And I realized I would never do that with something like prayer or tithing or service or hospitality. I would never think we could just leave that to the experts because there are people that are better. I would feel like we should really lean into those things even if we aren't good at it. So I felt convicted about that and found the Three Circles. In the midst of that, I think I overheard it on a Zoom call that my husband was having and decided that that would be a launching point to commit to figuring out evangelism as a spiritual discipline in my life. And it has been really cool. For the first month or so, I read the story of King David dancing before the Lord, and I would read it every day because a lot of the things in that story were things that I had wrapped around evangelism, like a lot of my fears. So King David was imperfect and he was kind of a mess, and he wasn't very eloquent. He was undignified and he was offending people. And I feel like that is a lot of how I feel when I do evangelism. I feel like I'm going to offend people, and I feel imperfect. I feel kind of like a mess in the midst of it, and like I'm stumbling over my words, and I feel undignified. So I read that every day for a while and realized that King David's worship was not in the dancing. King David's worship was in the obedience to dance. And so for me, my worship isn't in my eloquence or in my my perfection of doing the three circles or other evangelism. My worship is in my obedience to do what God has asked me to do. And with that in mind, that freed me a lot from a lot of just anxiety that I had about how good I was or how good I wasn't. And it really helped me to grow in my confidence of just doing it without really regard for how I looked or how I felt or even people's response to me. So that was really cool. My favorite story of the three circles is this girl named Alice. She came into the jail, and I've been going into the jail for a while, and nobody has ever scared me at the jail until I met Alice. And she was really kind of scary. And she, not only that, but just the fact that I was a Christian already offended her. So to take that next step and share the gospel was very scary. And she had kind of wounds from the church in her story. And so it felt like it could get a little messy. Like I could make some pretty big mistakes and be pretty undignified if I say the wrong thing or imply the wrong thing. But I did the three circles with Alice, and during it, she actually looked quite scary. She looked angry. And so I know a year ago, I would have stopped. I probably wouldn't have started, but if I had started, I probably would have stopped because she looked unsettled, or she looked just not happy with me, honestly. But when I finished, I asked her, "Alice, girl, you look annoyed. What's going on? What are you thinking?" And she just said, "You know, I'm not annoyed. I'm just thinking really hard about what the rest of my life is going to look like." And she accepted Christ. And now she's being a missionary on the inside of the jail. She's doing Bible studies. She's being mentored. She's reading scripture every day. And I know a year ago, I wouldn't have thought that I could do that. One, I would have thought that I would have messed that up. And I would have just not done it out of fear of offense. And so it has been really cool to see growth and to see change in that area where I would still say I'm not great at evangelism, but I wouldn't say that I'm not an evangelist. I would now say that I am walking out in evangelism, even though I'm not very eloquent at it. And that's a really cool place to be. I love growing in the Lord. And so to be able to look back on this past year and see that much growth has been really fun.
Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for new life in Christ. Think of it, Alice, so far from the Lord. And through the obedience and the preparedness of Aaron, Alice is now a missionary on the inside, as you heard. Great things happen when God's people are equipped and learn to be simply obedient to Jesus' great commission. Amen? People far from God can and do become disciples of Jesus, just like Alice. I want to focus in on one thing that Aaron said in that video. She said this, "King David's worship was not in the dancing. King David's worship was in his obedience to dance." Jesus saves sinners not because of our eloquence or quality of our speech, but in our simple obedience to share the good news of his gospel. It's not about how well you dance. And believe me, you would not want to see me dance. But it's about showing up and dancing. And friends, we have a dance. We have the EPC three-step. We do. It's God's design. in our brokenness. And Jesus, who comes to save sinners. That's the EPC three-step. It's the three circles. Now listen, I could tell you more here today, more stories from my church or our presbytery. I could tell you about Helen, who's in her 80s, well into her 80s, who has shared the three circles now a few times with her Hindu friend, who called her to say, hey, my dad's dying. I know when you pray, things happen. Would you pray for my dad? And they've been meeting. And Helen, who's in her 80s, has been teaching. I could tell you about Penny and Kathy. I could tell you about Isaac, but I don't have time to do that. So here's what I want to do. Here's how I want to conclude. I want to conclude with a plea. Our theme of this General Assembly is Ephesians 4:12, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. Friends, our church health team and our church health coordinators stand ready to equip the saints for the work of evangelism, for the building up of the body. Please use your presbytery coordinators. 15 of our 16 presbyteries have one. We are trained to walk alongside you to health, toward greater obedience to the Great Commission. We are available to you. We have tools in our toolbox for you, like assessments, prayer strategies, coaching, an entire process of moving churches from insulation to gospel engagement in their surrounding communities. We are continually, as coordinators, training and meeting monthly for peer accountability so that we can serve you better. Please call on us. Please use us. We are not experts, we are pastors, but we are trained and ready to help you point your people to the harvest. So friends, we are here to teach the EPC three-step. So let's dance. Amen? I want to invite my friend Mark to come and tell us more stories of the grace of Jesus Christ.
Blessings, brother. I really think that we should ask Jeff to dance because he did show us a three-step dance. It was like the four tops, the stylistics. I mean, it was great. So you should ask him to do that. 40 years ago, I would have never dreamed I'd be standing up in an evangelical Presbyterian church General Assembly. Why? My wife and I came here 40 years ago after seminary from Southern California. And I thought for sure we were going to work in Calvary Chapel. We were going to be part of the Jesus Revolution. Maybe you saw the movie. You know, funny thing happened when we got here. Calvary Chapel didn't get the message that we were supposed to be part of it. And that door slammed so hard in my face, my nose hurt for a long time. Before we left Southern California, God in His providence at seminary my last year had two people. One approached my wife, Mary Jane, and one approached me and said, hey, when you guys get out to Colorado, we know you're moving there, you should go see this Presbyterian pastor. His name's Fred Stiefel. I told those people, listen, I am not interested in being Presbyterian. You see, I grew up in a denominational church in Northwest Kansas, and two of my aunts were asked to leave the church because they taught in Sunday school, you must be born again. And I got a bias in my heart toward every denomination. I thought every denomination was apostate. And then I came here, and Calvary Chapel, the doors closed. I went to a secular job interview because I couldn't find anything. And the guy said to me, sorry, man, I don't have a job for you, but I do know this guy named Fred Stiefel, this Presbyterian minister. I'm like, God, what are you trying to do to me? I came kicking and screaming into the EPC. In 1983, I went to Faith Presbyterian. I had set in on the GA there. I was just trying to watch, who are these Presbyterians? What is this? I'd never been in a Presbyterian church. Who are they? What are they about? And I met people like Bart Hess and Andy Jumper, and I just was so amazed. And I got to tell you, it wasn't the P in the EPC that called me in, although now I love being a Presbyterian for many reasons. But what drew me into this denomination was the E. I saw this beautiful desire in people to to see people in heaven. And I was praying, God, Calvary Chapel closed the door to me. I need a place for us to hitch our wagon to. Show me the wagon train. And he did in his providence. He showed us the EPC, and I'm so glad to be here. That was 40 years ago, 1983. In 86, I was ordained, and I'm just so blessed to be with EPC World Outreach. And so I'm hoping this little clicker's gonna work so I can, when I hit that green thing, it means, yeah, here we go. And so I just wanna share a little bit about Three Circles and what it's meant to me in my life. It's one tool, you guys. I mean, I hear people sometimes say, hey, we don't like it when people kind of push things down on us from up on high. Hey, I am below you. I'm not pushing anything on you. I'm just a guy who loves Jesus, and the Three Circles has meant a lot to me. So I just want to share some stories and maybe some tips. And so here we go. I'm going to go fast. So I have the Three Circles on my phone so that everywhere I go, I am ready. And I remember my uncle said to me, my Uncle Bud, he was a Gideon in Northwest Kansas. He called me Marky. Marky, he said, too many Christians, when it comes to evangelism, look for excuses. We should be looking for opportunities. I still remember him saying that. And so look for opportunities. Pray for divine appointments. All of you, as you're going home, think of it, over 900 people here. How many gospel conversations could that be on the way home, in a plane, in a restaurant, wherever you go? God wants to use you. So look for opportunities. And then look for bridges. Look for common ground in a conversation. That's what I'll share a little bit more. And then share with joy. Do you love Jesus? You don't have to be an extrovert like me. Hey, I know plenty of introverts that talk about their favorite food, their favorite movie, their favorite sports. They get excited and it comes out. If you love Jesus, shouldn't it come out? So let me share some stories with you guys. This first one is about Scott, Army vet. Met him in the airport in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And I saw this on his computer. And so I had to talk to him, man. I said, hey, what's this about? I see the military insignia, you know. I know you're in the military. And what's up with that? And the whole thing about hell being full, so he decided to come back. And so he talked to me about his military life, doing drug interdiction in Panama and so forth. And I said, listen, you know, I want to tell you, man, I have a love for the military. In fact, the man who led me to Christ as a 10-year-old boy had been in the Bataan Death March in the Philippines. And he knew about that. And immediately, that was a bridge. And so then I said, I'm just curious about the whole thing with the hell thing here. And so he told me that was something that they had for their group. And I said, you know, I don't have a cool decal on my laptop, but I said, my job is sort of to help people not go to hell, so can I talk to you about a decal that I have on my phone? And so I just shared the Three Circles with Scott. And he went on his way, and I went on my way, but to me, so much of evangelism is planting seeds. Amen. Be a Johnny or Janie Appleseed, right? God's going to do something with it. This was Mrs. B. Oh, we love Mrs. B. She's in Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We went in there and I said, how you doing? She said, I'm above ground. I said, well, what happens when you're below ground? And she just looked at me real seriously and she said, I'm trying to mend my ways. And I said, can I just share something with you? So I pull out my phone and I go through the Three Circles because I wanted her to know that mending her ways is not the same as repentance. That mending her ways in her thought was works. She had to do good works. She had to change the bad ways, throw in some good ways, and she'd get to heaven. And so I got to share with her the glorious gospel, and I've done it 2 years in a row with her. This is one of my favorite stories. This is my wife Mary Jane's aunt and uncle, Gene and Jean. I think I can say their names. Gene and Jean are 93. We sat down with them for lunch one day, and was talking to them, and I said, I did the evangelism explosion question. I learned a long time ago. I love this question. If you were to die tonight and appear before God and he asked you, why should I allow you into my heaven? What would you say? Wow, I tell you guys, that question, I love it. You get right to the root of what people are counting on. And so Gene said, well, my dad raised me from a little boy to be a kind person, and he is, to help people, and he does. And then I turned to Gene. He had been a Presbyterian elder. And I said to Gene, about those good things, I said, then why did Jesus come and die on the cross? And Gene said in the quietest voice and looked down, he said, I really don't know. A Presbyterian elder. So I shared the gospel with him, and he got it. And we prayed right in the restaurant. And then we went back to their apartment, and we told his wife. I thought she'd be angry. I did, because I won't go into why. And she said, I want that. I want to pray. It was so cool to see these people in their 90s finally getting the gospel. Wow. Three circles. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. This guy, he's from Iran. We went into his restaurant. I shared the three circles with him after conversation. He said, I threw my religion in the trash a long time ago. He's in that place where I kind of was with denominations, but he's that way now with any religion. He doesn't want anything to do with any religion. But you know what? We went back there a year ago. He goes, yeah, I remember that thing you showed me on your phone. I remember that. He's not ready yet. That's okay. That's all right. But he's hearing, and he's feeling loved by somebody. This is Roy, 76 years old. Here I am sitting in a restaurant in Jinx, Oklahoma, after a men's meeting. I'm there by myself doing some stuff, email, I don't know what it was. And this guy comes in, he's got his OU, Oklahoma Sooners pullover on, and I hear his phone ring, and it's his ringtone is Hotel California. Now, I don't know if you know that song, but I said, man, that's an interesting ringtone you got there. Do you know much about Hotel California? He said, no, I really don't. I said, well, you know, there's that line in there toward the end that says something like, you can check in, but you can't check out, and so forth. And I started talking to him, and we were just in conversation, so I asked him that same EE question. Hey, Roy, if you were to die tonight, appear before God, and he said to you, why should I allow you into my heaven? He said, listen, he said, I help people every day. He said, I'm a widower, but I have a girlfriend. She's been bedridden for like 5 years, and I go to see her every day in the care facility, and they told me at the care facility that no one else is like me. Nobody else visits like that. So I shared the three circles with him, and he said, you know, yeah, he said, I got something Jesus on my dashboard, and I got a Bible app. And I said, well, can I ask you one more time now that I've shared this with you? What are you counting on to get to heaven? And he got kind of aggravated at me, and he said, well, what do you want me to say? I said, well, Roy, I want you to say that if you appear before God, that you're counting on Jesus. You're counting on what he did for you, not how good you can be, because the Bible says in Galatians 2:21 that if right standing with God comes by works of the law, by being a good person, then Christ died needlessly. And I went away just grieved about Roy, because he still doesn't get it. And so, Lord, bring Roy to yourself. Bring him to yourself. This is a dear man to us. We love Muslims. That's most of our ministry now with World Outreach. It's part of it. And this man has become a dear friend. I bet, how many of you know where Mauritania is? Anybody know where Mauritania is? Boy, I tell you, not very many folks, but it's below Morocco and the Sahara. And we've become good friends with this man. And MJ and I, my wife and I shared the gospel with him using the three circles one night. And I had to use my phone, not just on the back, but I had to use Google Translate because he speaks Arabic. And it was a little rough. But then I was copying and pasting scriptures from Arabic, from Romans 3, Romans 6, Romans 5, just sharing with him the gospel. And he just, you know, he didn't do the common Muslim thing. Hey, Jesus didn't die on the cross. He just asked the question, is that why I see crosses on so many buildings? you know, he's getting closer. And we just love him. We love to share with him. Then there's Cody. Cody's the young guy, the long-haired, bearded dude that I get on the airplane with because MJ and I are going to some ministry trip and we're going to Dallas from Grand Rapids, Michigan, where we live. I'm sitting there with Cody, asking him about himself. He said, well, I'm a dirt bike racer. And he said, I was raised Catholic and I'm ADHD. That's what he told me about himself. So I said, I don't know. Oh, I know what happened. It's what it says right there. We're climbing up, and the pilot says we're approaching 30,000 feet. And Cody just turns to me and says, man, I hope we don't go down. And I said, well, what if we do go down? He said, well, we just go poof. And I said, well, Cody, what happens after that? He just said, I really don't know. So I said, well, can I share something with you? So I pull up my phone and share the three circles. What else would I do? And so you know what's cool about Cody? Cody's a guy that reading stuff on paper doesn't work for him. And so after when I finished, he said, you know, nobody has ever shared anything about religion with a visual aid, and that's what I needed. And I get most of what you're saying because of this. He said, can I take a picture of that? And so he took a picture of my three circles. And so that's just, it's seed planting so much of what we do, right? We're looking for opportunities. We're finding common ground. This is Mr. A. He's from Algeria. He has the best yogurt, all the flavors. It's unbelievable. And we met him in Arizona, where he camps out with his business, a bunch of people with their businesses in a big, giant Southern Baptist Church parking lot on Wednesdays and Saturdays. So every year when we go down there to see our kids, I go see this guy, Mr. A, from Algeria. And I shared the three circles with him. I was there twice. We were there twice this time. And as I went over to him the second week we were there, he said, when are you leaving? I said, we're leaving tomorrow, so I won't see you for another year. He left his customers and came around and hugged me. Now, I want to tell you guys something about people in the service industry. They oftentimes are treated poorly by people. You know this, right? They're treated poorly sometimes even by Christians. Hey, please don't be those Sunday Christians who go to church and then you go out to eat and you leave a big mess and no tip. Because that hurts those people. They have an image of God coming from you. And so I want to just share that we were with our friends Ron and Melissa. We pastored a singles group at Faith Presbyterian here from 1983 to 1986. And Ron and Melissa were part of that. And we got together with them on Sunday after coming to the service here. I said, Melissa, what's your story? She said, well, I want to tell you the turning point in my spiritual life because I saw Christians as hypocrites. The turning point in my Christian life was when I went, when I was working at Coco's as a server, and this EPC pastor would come in all the time, and he just treated me with kindness. And he shared, and that started to turn her. And not long after that, she was born again. And so how we treat people that sell and serve is so important. This is Mr. V from Cambodia. We got in our Uber in Grand Rapids, and Mary Jane's wearing her Broncos pullover. And he says to us, are you guys from Denver? We said, oh, we lived there. We lived there 83 to 86. He said, oh, man, I'm a Bronco fan. I lived there the same time you guys did. And so we have a bridge there, but I'm looking for the next bridge. And I said, tell me, Mr. V, are you from Southeast Asia, you know, maybe Cambodia, Laos? He said, yeah, I'm from Cambodia. I said, wow. I said, we know this guy. He's in the Denver, Colorado area. Satan Lee, some of you know him. He's an ordained EPC teaching elder. And he's from Cambodia. He escaped the Khmer Rouge. And we told his testimony to this guy. And then we said on the way, it was kind of a long drive from our place to the airport. And I said, Mr. B, tell me, can you tell me about your faith? You know, and he said, well, he said, I really believe that God made it so all faiths get people to heaven. Well, I said, how's that? He said, well, being good, obeying the rules. There's basic rules to every religion, and being good's the way. And I shared with him a bunch of scriptures. And then we got out of the car, and I showed him the three circles. And so we just were looking for opportunities. We used those bridges, and then I went and visited him. He has another business, which is a restaurant. And so we're trying to keep up with him and keep planting more seeds. Mary Jane had on her Bronco pullover again. We're in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and this guy, we're getting up to leave after we have this great salad. And Jeremy says, "Hey, are you a Bronco fan?" We just start talking football. Now, I can talk football all day long. I love football. And this guy did too. I said, "Hey, you know, I mentioned that I did some chapels for the Atlanta Falcons." So he was, you know, I started that bridge. I said, "Hey, can I share with you something on my phone?" And so I shared the three circles. I said, "What do you think?" He said, "You know," he said, "I was saved. I was baptized. And then I read some stuff, and now I'm an agnostic." And he literally turned his back on us and went back to his friends like that. And I thought, man, God, that's good. I mean, it's good. I need that. I don't need everybody I need people to hear and think about it. Think about the commitment they're going to make. And so be ready to be rejected if you're going to share Jesus. That's okay. It's all right. And this is my last story, and then just a couple of points to close with. So here we are with Pastor Josh and his wife, Sarah, and we're down in the deep south, man. We're in Mississippi. And we go out and visit a mosque together. And at the end of this time, where the men are in one area eating, the women are in another area, and I'm sharing the three circles with a Muslim guy, Palestinian. And at the same time, unbeknownst to me, my wife is coming down the steps that you see in that picture, and she just somehow missed one step and fell, like 10 steps, and hurt her back. And I'm thinking, man, God, I guess there is a little opposition to this message, isn't there? And so, praise God, you can expect some opposition. You can expect people not to like you. It's all right. That's not why we're doing this. And so let me just, I'm trying to hit this thing, guys, but I'm getting hung up for some reason. Yeah, I just want to end by saying this. I believe evangelism is much more about our hearts than it is about our methods. I love the three circles. It gives me a tool. It's easy, it's adaptable, it's flexible, but it's all about our hearts. It starts in the heart. I think that we need to have an understanding of not just EPC motives for evangelism, but biblical motives. And the first one to me is the love of Christ. The second one is the judgment seat of Christ. I don't want to appear before Jesus. I don't want him to wipe away tears from my eyes because I didn't share him with people. I don't want to be that person. And then the compassion of Jesus. He looked at lost people with compassion. And then the candor of Christ. Jesus was not afraid to talk about hell. The parable, the story of Lazarus and the rich man strikes me so much. And you know what gets me the most about it? Is that one of the people that cares about evangelism almost more than anybody else in the whole Bible is the man in Hades who said to Abraham, "Father Abraham, please send Lazarus back. I've got five brothers and I don't want them to come to this place of torment." Do you believe in hell? Does it bother anybody that people are going to hell? Are we so hyper-Calvinistic that we think like they said to, go to the next one, please, guys. I'm having trouble with the remote. Are we like the guys who said to William Carey, the father of modern missions, "Young man, sit down. You're an enthusiast. When God pleases to save the heathen, he'll do it without your help or mine." Oh, I don't want to be that person. I want to be Calvinistic enough to believe that in his sovereignty, salvation belongs to the Lord. But I want to have the compassion of Christ for lost people. I want to be like Paul, who said he had sorrow and anguish in his heart over the lost. My last reason, biblical reason, for evangelism is the satisfaction of Christ. At the end of Isaiah 53, it says he'll see his offspring And then after that, the next verse, he'll be satisfied. I want Jesus to receive all the glory that he deserves. And so one more thing is I have taken way too much time, and Thomas has been so gracious to me and Bob Stauffer. I want the lamb that was slain to receive the reward of his suffering. Hey, teaching elders, of whom I am one, can I beg you, don't get trapped in your office. You need to be out with unbelievers. You cannot tell them to evangelize if you're not doing it. And ruling elders, please, I beg you, don't be like that church where my friend was hired by an EPC church and the ruling elders told him, we did not hire you to change the world. We hired you to take care of us. I beg you, teaching elders, I love you. Oh, I love you so much. I pray for you. Share with the lost. Get out there. You can do it. And ruling elders, why don't you put your arm around your pastor next Sunday and say, hey, brother, hey, sister, did you take some time this week to get out of the office and be with some unbelievers, to love on them, to share Jesus? Let's do it for the love of Christ, because of the judgment seat of Christ, the candor of Christ, and most of all, the satisfaction of Christ. Amen.
Hey, everybody. So, Mark, thank you for that. Mark Vanderput is one of my favorite people, and I encouraged him to take as much time as he needed because Mark has an infectious disease, and I want you to catch it. So, thank you. So, I'm Thomas Davis. I serve under the leadership of Gabriel DeGuia with EPC World Outreach. I'm a gospel outreach coach. My wife Carrie and I live in the Charlotte area. We have 3 children. We, a few years ago, hit kind of a midlife crisis. Where's the fruit, right? And so we've been involved in global outreach for 25 years, connections around the world. We had spent time around the world, and we were hearing increasingly about these amazing stories of tremendous breakthrough taking place in certain pockets and places. And sort of in a midlife crisis, where's the fruit? I set out to find out what God was doing in those places. I started meeting with people. I traveled to places, met with people I knew. I met with friends of friends and friends of friends of friends. And you can get pretty much around the world by doing that, right? And so I connected with all these folks, and I discovered 2 things. One is that the way God did it in each place was a little bit different. Each context was different. The second thing I discovered was that there were some core practices and principles in place in each one of those. And I'm not going to unpack those for you, but I'm going to tease you. So I particularly zoomed in on evangelism. Like, because these are movements of personal evangelism. These are movements of disciples making disciples by getting out, sharing their faith with people, leading them to Christ, discipling them, and teaching them immediately to go and share their faith with others. And this disciple making disciple movement has been happening around the world. And so we drilled down, did a lot of research, and massaged it, and found out that there were really 7 practices in place where these churches are filled with disciples of Jesus who are practicing these 7 biblical principles. And I'm not going to unpack them for you, but if you go to one of the world outreach tables over in the atrium, there's a stack of these articles. It's about a 2,000-word article. I encourage you to grab it. It has my email address on there, so if you have questions, feel free to let me know. But I think these are practices and principles that are applicable universally for the body of Christ. These are just the basic practices of discipleship. And so I'm praying that we as a movement would make disciples who make disciples. Now, the reason I wanted to mention that to you in the context of church health is that about a year and a half ago, Bob Stauffer invited In the spirit of collaboration, he went to Gabriel and said, hey, we're doing this Three Circles training. Would you send some folks from World Outreach to be a part of it? And Gabriel volunteered Mark and me, and so we got on a plane and landed in Orlando, and we went through the Three Circles training, and Bob and I started talking. And I realized that these seven practices really aligned beautifully with the Three Circles, which we describe as a way to communicate the big idea of the Bible. And so you'll find that one of the principles here is that these disciples have learned how to succinctly communicate the big idea of the Bible. And so Bob, as those discussions continued, he said, Thomas, you know, we're in this new phase of collaboration between the gospel priorities. Would you consider, I know your day job is with World Outreach and you're doing your thing there, but would you consider joining the National Church Health Team and helping us as a church health team and as a denomination think about evangelism? And I didn't have to pray about that very long at all. I said yes. I was driving down the interstate and Bob asked me, and before he could get the question out, I was like, yes, when do I start, you know? And so we've jumped in. Now, as I jumped into this church health community, one of Bob's hooks that really got me was he said, Thomas, we are convinced that a healthy church is an evangelistic church. And I thought, I'm on board with that. Let's roll, right? But I confess that I had a little bit of skepticism, right? Like, I thought, is for this church health group, is this aspirational? Or are these guys really doing it? And I kind of thought, I'm going to come in and join this group of church health coordinators and church health national leaders, and I'm going to really help them think about evangelism, and I'm going to help them see the biblical mandate for evangelism, and I'm going to inspire them and challenge them and encourage them. And I got in there, And I was like, I found a band who was already playing the
perfect.
Yeah, so I discovered that these guys were already doing it. And so I want to commend to you Bob Stauffer and the church health team. I'm an outsider. I serve with World Outreach, right? But I get the privilege of hanging out with these guys, and they are practicing what they preach. They are training the Three Circles, but they are also out sharing the gospel themselves. And so if you don't know your church health coordinator, my challenge for you, before you leave here this week, find out who that is and see if you can meet them, okay? And so I just want to share with you in closing, just this really brief story. So I get to join these guys in offering Three Circles training, and so I'm speaking in churches, and we're training mission teams, and so we're doing Three Circles training a lot. One of our principles, one of our practices here that we discovered was that folks leading others to Jesus through personal evangelism, they share the gospel early and often. Well, we're happy to be involved at St. Giles EPC in Charlotte under the leadership of Nate Atwood, and so we've done a fair amount of training in that context, and they've been gracious to allow us to do that. There's one young woman in our church named Kate, and Kate has evident love for Jesus. She went through our training, got really stirred up about this idea of sharing Jesus early and often. She said, I never thought about that, right? And so we teach people how to just fish, right? How to share just a little bit to find out who's interested so you can share more. So Kate did this, started practicing this, and recently she was in a context where she, in a social gathering, met a young professional in the Charlotte area from a Muslim background from India. Kate, using her own approach to fishing, she walked up to him and said, hey, I was just wondering what you believe about God. And I thought, well, that'll do it, right? And so he says, well, I'm from a Muslim background, but I've been thinking a lot about Jesus. And Kate's eyes got big. She had a little bit of conversation with him. She knew for cultural reasons it would be important to have a man follow up with him. She said, here's my friend Thomas's mobile number. If you text him, I'm sure he would meet with you. Just a few hours later, he texted me. We met. I shared the Three Circles with him. He professed faith in Christ. He's actively involved in our church. We're meeting regularly for discipleship. And so I just want to say that I believe in the Three Circles because I have this conviction that it's a model that is effective. It helps us communicate the big idea of the Bible. So I'm thankful for Church Health. I'm thankful for Bob. Now, we're going to transition. And I want to invite Mark DeJay and Keon Abner to come on up. And we're going to shift gears here just a little bit with Church Health, and they are going to lead us in a session called Love Thy Neighborhood. They're going to help us think about how can we exegete our neighborhood so that we are reaching out effectively and strategically in the context in which we live.